behavior, and I work as a dedicated sustainability analyst for the Global Tech Leader Strategy at Janus Henderson. And what that means in practice is that I am responsible in responsible of the ESG integration for two global equity portfolio strategies, one an Article 8 fund, the Global Tech Leaders Strategy, two an Article 9 fund, the Sustainable Future Tech Strategy. And both of them are investing global tech equities, but both of them have different kind of focus areas, different themes that they focus on. And so, for example, for our Article 9 fund, which is our Sustainable Future Tech Fund, which we launched just 2 years now, I think, just about 2 years now. You know, the themes that we focus on are across both environmental and socially focused, from things like clean energy tech to tech health to resource and productivity optimization, smart cities, sustainable transport, and many more themes, including low carbon infrastructure that touches upon themes such as AI. And I think, you know, one of the things that we've really focused on in the last couple of months has really been that theme of AI. So I'm happy to go into more detail about that later. But what would be great is if Sam, maybe you could introduce yourself and then Laura before we launch into the panel.
Thank you, Kimberly, and great seeing all of you, 50 participants. That's great. So I am from Fulcrum Asset Management. I sit in the Alternative Solutions team, which essentially means all your slightly unique, quirky stocks, unlike your traditional equities and bonds. So we look at real assets, alternative credit, EMD, as well as VC and PE, so venture capital and private equity going forward as well. On a broader lens, I'm also a sustainability lead for my team, as well as a part of the sustainability team at Fulcrum. So I kind of have two hats from an investment and ESG lens. It's an exciting role because ESG is such a great topic, and look forward to discussing that with you today.
Great, thanks so much. So my name is Laura Cooper, and I'm a senior macro investment strategist over at BlackRock. And essentially what I do is I run a team of strategists, and we are really meant to produce macro research as well as generate tactical investment ideas. And we share those with our institutional client base, our wealth client base, as well as internal portfolio managers here at BlackRock. So we are multi-asset. We are kind of across the country, across the globe. So we're quite involved in the current market landscape. So very happy to kind of touch on key themes that we're seeing, whether it's recession, inflation, and really how we're seeing investors position in this quite challenging type of backdrop.
Perfect. Thank you so much. I think, Laura, I'd love to jump into that in a little bit more detail straight off the bat. I'd love for you to give us a bit of an overview of what the macro looks like for us investors, looking at both equity and the bond markets. And, you know, really going into detail, you know, is this a stock picker's market or not? What are you thinking in terms of, you know, valuation discipline, unprofitable companies? Would love to hear your thoughts on that.
It's a great question. I think certainly probably the key trend that we are seeing face investors right now is around inflation. So inflation has been quite high, clearly well above central bank targets. Now, if we can think about what has driven inflation, it really came off the back of the pandemic. We had these supply disruptions at the same time that everybody all of a sudden had to demand goods because they were locked down in their homes and they couldn't really consume the typical services. So we did see that really drive these inflationary pressures, and we are seeing that inflation continue to persist. So in response, we've seen central banks aggressively raise their policy rates. Why have they done this? Well, essentially, if they make the cost of capital more expensive, that should in turn curb some of the demand. And so we should see some of those price pressures start to ease. So we have seen the Federal Reserve raise rates about 5.5 percentage points in the span of just over 18 months. Similar for the Bank of England, they've raised rates quite aggressively to that 5.25% mark. And this really sets the macro framing for how investors are currently looking at the landscape. We can think about equity markets so far this year on the surface. Up until about July or August, have been fairly resilient. The US has largely been driven, though, by seven key mega cap stocks, which I know we're going to kind of dig into a bit further. We have seen a bit more of a pullback since then, largely because investors are starting to take notice to the fact that this is an environment where interest rates are likely going to remain elevated for quite some time. So we have seen a sell-off in equity markets. Valuations are a little bit cheaper, but I think it's really about being quite selective and finding those pockets that are kind of more appropriately priced given the significant economic challenges that we still face going forward. But I really think that the key trend this year is not really in equities, which is kind of surprising, but it's really what's been happening in the bond markets. So in this environment where central banks have aggressively raised rates, it really has led to this higher yielding environment. So the US 10-year government bond yield, typically a good proxy for where we're currently seeing bond markets, it actually just breached 5% last week, which is the highest that we've seen since well before the global financial crisis. And so we have seen clearly bonds under pressure that is now starting to have ripple effects in terms of equity markets. And I think this really just reflects that investors are demanding higher compensation to lock in these yields because we are in this environment where inflation is probably going to be here to stay for quite some time. It's quite volatile. There's this renewed interest rate volatility as well because there's uncertainty on what central banks are doing. So about positioning, you know, we are still seeing quite selective opportunities in equities and bond markets, but probably taking on a little bit less of that kind of what we call long duration exposure, really looking for kind of clipping coupon income at the front end of sovereign curves and then looking for pockets of opportunities in equities, whether that's regional or whether that's sector specific.
Absolutely. And I think I would echo that just anecdotally, you know, talking to clients and talking, looking at tech, you know, equity inflows, outflows. There's been a real kind of not a return to risk, basically, you know, that we had a huge outflows and we had, you know, low risk kind of appetites and that risk appetite hasn't grown substantially. And so, yeah, absolutely. Just like you're saying, you know, we're still seeing that kind of pressure and really having to be selective. And for us as a fund, especially, we have a clear valuation discipline when we look at tech investments. We navigate the hype cycle. And so we've seen some real opportunities there. But we've also seen similar funds not have that valuation discipline and have some real issues there. So I think that's really fascinating. I think one of the things that I always hear from my clients are, you know, the debate about, you know, will we actually have a recession or not? Like, what will this look like in different geographies? One of our key tech holdings, Trimble, called it a multi-modular market. Basically, they're seeing some real sectors and geographies with deep recessionary territories, but they're seeing some real strength and growth. And one of our themes, next generation or low carbon infrastructure, seeing real, you know, strength and drive through AI spend, but also through kind of enterprise spending being more resilient than expected, the US consumer being more resilient than expected and not having that real drop off. So I'd love to hear your views around this and how does this differ in different geographies, you know, from China to the UK to the US, which I think have all got quite unique areas.
Well, for anybody who watches these markets, and certainly from a macro perspective, I think that's been the key puzzle so far this year. Why has the US economy been as resilient as it has been? We saw Q3 economic growth come out last week. It was quite strong. And yet the central bank has raised rates to levels that we haven't seen in quite some time. So we largely underpin this to the resilience of the consumer because during the pandemic, consumers built up these cushions of savings. And so they've been able to use those as a really kind of a way to kind of navigate through this higher inflation environment. So we are thinking now the consumer is going to come under pressure, but the US could actually avoid a recession because it's a very less interest rate sensitive economy than it has been in the past, in part because of the health of the consumer. But I think if we kind of come across the pond and thinking about where we are in Europe, I think Europe is clearly in a recession. You know, we've seen manufacturing activity be quite pressured in Germany. We are seeing kind of leading economic gauges suggest that really the export picture is quite dim. And so I would argue that Europe is likely going to be in recession by the end of the year. Similar story for the UK. The UK growth backdrop has been fairly resilient despite the backup that we have seen in yields that are really amplifying the cost of capital in these geographies. And I guess the key question then is from an investor perspective, Do you want to re-risk across broad equity benchmarks right now? Probably not, because of the uncertainty about the growth backdrop, as well as the uncertainty around central banks are going to do. We think the Bank of England has probably paused their tightening, the Fed is likely paused, but there is still this uncertainty given the inflation outlook. So it's about finding those opportunities where we think those recession risks are already in the price. So small caps, for example, in the US, or we can think about energy in Europe. Valuations are quite depressed. It really is already pricing in those recessions. And then if we think about the European government bond space, so German yields are trading, close to 3%, levels that we really haven't seen in quite some time, but yet the growth and inflation dynamics are very different than what we see in the US. So there's probably more of an opportunity to kind of take on really the debt backdrop in this type of challenging environment. But I would say it's a very selective stock picker, active type of space right now, given the uncertainties in this market.
If we don't return to that kind of low interest rate environment again, if we do have higher interest rates for longer, if we have higher levels of inflation for longer, what are kind of the indicators that we should maybe look out for, or something that's interesting in terms of investors to change the attitude, to put risk back on? I know that's a real out there question, and there's probably about a million answers to this, but it would be great to hear your views on it.
I think the key guidepost that investors are watching for now is really the guidance that's coming from central banks. So central banks are starting to kind of tilt towards taking a little bit more of a dovish stance, in the sense that they have raised rates quite aggressively. Typically, monetary policy works with a lag of about 4 to 6 quarters. So we really likely need to see more clarity on the policy front about when they could potentially start to cut policy rates, because this is a very different type of dynamic, in that inflation, we're probably in what we call a new inflation regime, where inflation is higher than it has been over the past several decades. And so central banks are likely going to be more reluctant to cut rates when inflation is still above target. So we're probably going to need to see more kind of easing signals from policymakers to really re-risk. Or we would need to see a trough in the economic data. So in Europe, if we start to look at the PMIs, which typically a leading economic indicator, if those start to have an upturn, if we start to see more resilience in US economic activity, where clearly we're seeing the US economy slow, but a recession can still be avoided, I think those are really kind of the macro signals that investors are watching for signs that we could be at the start of a new kind of bull market for equities.
Absolutely. And key for us, obviously, in the equity space, we are a forward discounting market. And so, we try to see these indicators as early as possible. And so sometimes, you see real rebounds even before, the actual improvements have actually happened. So always key to highlight, I think. And the Magnificent Seven stocks that you mentioned, Laura, so those are all mega cap tech, Nvidia, Tesla, Meta, Apple, Amazon, Microsoft, and Alphabet. And they've really surged, especially in the first half of the year, in large part thanks to enthusiasm around artificial intelligence, as I mentioned, but also due to their strong balance sheets and more resilient enterprise spend and exposure to the US. We've seen some real interest around those names. They had been slightly depressed in terms of multiples, but their earnings are staying resilient as well. Interesting for me is Tesla, for example, who's recently seen some losses as that EV hype cycle has kind of plummeted with, interest rates being higher, lower demand and margin pressures as pricing is being forced downwards. Even the US has something called the Inflation Reduction Act, which was this big kind of green package spending that they announced, and those dollars haven't really been released or spent as quickly as we expected. Apple's suffered from signs of an economic slowdown in China, and a major factor driving these recent lackluster performance is that recent run-up in bond yield, as you mentioned, which has accompanied unexpectedly resilient economic data and the market's adjustment to the Federal Reserve's higher for longer strategy on that interest rates. Higher rates drag on growth stocks because they make future earnings less valuable. However, they're still well placed to benefit from their strong balance sheet and their more resilient customers and AI. And so for us, it's really key is navigating this, valuation discipline and ability to navigate hype cycles and seeing where the pockets of real growth will be. Within tech, AI is all everything anybody wants to really talk about nowadays. We see personally tech as the science of solving problems, and we see AI as the fourth wave of compute, you know, behind the computer, behind the mobile phone. And tech is a deflationary force, so it's making things cheaper, and AI is no different. You know, AI transformation is estimated to drive double-digit trillion-scale dollar GDP accretion in the next decade. And AI was brought into everyone's mind early in the year through ChatGPT. I mean, according to OpenAI, ChatGPT acquired 1 million users in 5 days. You know, comparing that to Instagram, that took about 2.5 months. Netflix took about 3.5 years. And so we've just seen this real acceleration. And I think one thing that we really need to enforce here is, you know, there's a difference between generative AI and not to be mistaken with what Hollywood depicts as general artificial intelligence, right? We're not there yet, right? We haven't got general artificial intelligence. We don't have the bots coming to get us. Generative AI is basically something, you know, to enhance human user experience, enhance human jobs, you know, it uses large data sets to effectively predict the most likely next word or image. And so it's really is something quite different to kind of like that general intelligence that people have seen in Hollywood. Key to unlocking, you know, generative AI and also high performance compute is, you know, something called a GPU, which is a graphics processing unit. And basically it's designed for parallel processing, which allows multiple calculations at the same time. It's often tailored to a specific use case. Versus what we used previously, which is the computer processing unit, which does things in a serial manner, so one after the other, and can't like break up a task into little bits and parallel process like the GPU can, and is a lot more clever in terms of it can do lots of different stuff, whereas the GPU, like I said, maybe will be tailored to more one specific stuff, so it'll be more optimized and can do that. And so NVIDIA, one of the Magnificent Seven, that has really, you know, boosted especially the US into the stock market over the last few months, is basically dominating here in the GPU space. And they've pioneered an AI and high performance compute kind of ecosystem and platform approach, you know, from building those GPUs to also acceleration libraries and building a whole kind of like ecosystem and stack around what that is. Other conversations this year on AI has been around, you know, what could revenue generation look like beyond just the architecture and names like NVIDIA? And that would be things like, you know, Copilots. Microsoft has launched their Copilot, and that's driven incremental more customers back to the platform, but also the ability to charge an extra subscription fee because of the performance enhancements, improvements that this Copilot can bring and make our jobs a lot easier in different areas. And so it'll be interesting then to see like where AI moves next to, you know, specific AI systems are built and how we move away from just the ecosystem enablers and the physical infrastructure to the AI platform and foundation models and the software and applications. So that's seen some real kind of outperformance. And so for us, next generation infrastructure, low carbon infrastructure, names beyond NVIDIA have been quite resilient in terms of that. And those Magnificent Seven, many of them have benefited from that AI wave as well. So I think that's really something that's been on our investor minds. Now, Sam, you know, you just introduced us to your universe of ESG and sustainability, and a big topic across the investment world, regardless of the style or geographic focus, remains ESG. We're still awaiting regulation, you know, on ESG from both the US and the UK, while at the same time implementing the European Sustainable Financial Disclosure Regulation and participating in consultations around that. You know, for us, you know, what ESG means and in sustainability means can vary fund on fund, company on company, regulation on regulation. But what I'd really like to understand is for you, how do you navigate this? How does Fulcrum navigate this? And what does ESG mean for your company?
Yeah, a lot to unpack there. And I think ESG investing is just such a big topic, and it ranges from, you know, responsible investment in the spectrum of capital on one side to philanthropy and impact investing. I think where we sit is really in the sustainable investment category, where we look at returns and ESG positive impacts in an equal lens. We're not an impact fund, so that's how we really approach it. But I think the first part is actually quite interesting, which is ESG varies significantly. And I think regulators have been clamping down on what really ESG means. I think that term has been used and misused multiple times. I think for us, the way that we really look at sustainable investing is through an eye of real world impact. And I think what that means is that everything that we do, we want to achieve net zero by 2050, which is what we've committed to. And within our fund, by 2030, we want to reduce half of our emissions. And that's literally looking at a very singular emission called the WACI, which is how we calculate emissions for our fund, financed emissions. And it's by reducing that over time. Now, what's quite interesting with that is that there's so many various ways on how the industry has been discussing about how do we get to net zero, and can the financial sector actually do anything about net zero, or is that something that's not really for us to work on? I think for us, it's extremely important that not only do we allocate where we have said, and that is, looking at themes like clean energy, looking at mega trends, climate change being a key mega trend, and investing accordingly, but also through engagement. I think where we sit within the alternatives, we are a multi-asset fund and therefore have various engagement tools at our disposal, whether it's voting, stewardship, direct engagement, collective engagement. There's a whole series of tools that we can use, and it's an extremely time-consuming job to actually engage well. And I think one thing that I'm always, when speaking to university students, it's this idea between divestment and investment and where that line is. I find that very fascinating. I think when I was at university, LSE had a huge divestment campaign. And I think there is definitely a line in the sand that we need to draw. But when we look at real world impact and how we can actually bring down emissions, it is through effective engagement, or as I like to call engagement with teeth. When you own the stock, where in equities, where you are able to vote on it, or where you have a company in your portfolio, you have a say in it. And therefore, through engagement, you can literally create a pathway to decarbonization, which you can't if you divest from it. And I think with divestment, the biggest issue is, well, if I don't own it, someone else is going to own it, and they might not care about ESG at all. And I think tobacco companies are an interesting example because, on one hand, there has been that collective effort in our industry to divest from tobacco. But what it's also led to is tobacco companies doing really well in places like Indonesia and the EM markets. So there is that balance. I think what this year has actually shown us is the importance of energy transition and how we need to do it in a more pragmatic way. But it's also shown us that we can't take excuses. I mean, there's been a lot of backlash against sustainable investing. And I think that's also led to a lot of funds out there moving away from it. I think the way that we approach it at Fulcrum is that climate change is one of our five pillars. We're investing heavily in it rather than cutting headcount. We think that there's immense risk to our portfolio, but also opportunity for growth. And I think from that double materiality lens, which is not only how we look at risk to our portfolio, but our risk to the ecosystem, we think climate change is a theme that is here to stay, and we need to be an active participant in engaging with it. I think your second comment on regulation is also very fascinating. I am extremely empathetic to our regulators who have tried and really tried hard to create regulations around greenwashing, taxonomy, what ESG investing actually means. I think there is that nudge and that push from regulators, which is leading to a lot of excitement in the market, whilst from our political stakeholders and society leading to a pull. So there is that push and pull, which is very exciting to be in. The way that I think about it is that if we are discussing this to such an extent, it means that ESG is now embedded and a mature industry. I think initially everyone kind of jumped on the bandwagon, not really knowing what it was. And I think now that we're actually having those discussions and discourses, I can say that I think we're matured as an industry, and I think that's always a positive.
Absolutely. And I think it's fascinating in terms of kind of like the shift in focus, the shift of what ESG means for the regulator and also what it means in the industry and the constant change. It's also exciting. I am a dedicated sustainability analyst, and one of the key things for me, coming out of university only about 5 years ago now, so relatively new, was that I could learn fast in a dynamic, fast-paced way, And you know, my opinion also mattered, even though, you know, I'd only been in the industry maybe 1 or 2, 3 years. You know, I had seen a lot of change on ESG. I had read a lot about ESG, and because there were a limited amount of ESG experts, I was probably given opportunities quite early on in the space that were really exciting for me and my career, just anecdotally. So I think that's also exciting. And you know, the changing world and the shifting regulation also means opportunities in the future and areas where we can really put our mark and influence and impact positively. So I think that's also really exciting for us as well. I would agree on the engagement side of things. You know, engagement is takes a lot of work, but engagement can be very valuable. And for us, we recently published a white paper where we looked at, you know, do ESG factors even influence valuation of tech stocks? And for us, it was a clear yes. In a statistically significant amount of cases, it did, you know, enhance valuation. And so we have a real conversation to be had with our companies on how they can position themselves on ESG, how they can ensure that they are sustainable in the future, how they are focusing on financially material ESG factors, and ensuring that that is reflected in their valuation, that that is reflected, you know, in their ability to operate in the future, their license to operate, and also in their, you know, sales and demand, in every kind of aspect, you know, employee recruitment, ESG factors in a lot of those things. And I think it's really important for us investors to help that conversation and make sure it's a dialogue.
Completely. And I think those discussions that you had earlier about the resiliency of balance sheets apply to ESG as well. I think, especially in the clean tech space and the clean energy space, we've really seen the importance of stock picking and almost that active management style and resiliency of balance sheet being paramount in the success of this field. And I think what you said with the tech industry is actually very fascinating, because I think often, at least when I was in university, I would constantly think about ESG as one metric. And I think it's only through time, and I think as an industry, we've also evolved to understand that it is more composite than that. It's a range of metrics that we need to take into account. I think the tech industry is very interesting because initially when ESG kind of came into play, a lot of portfolios had tech companies, and green sustainable portfolios had tech companies because they didn't look at scope three emissions, which is the emissions from supply chains. And I think we are evolving in an as an industry, and we're constantly looking at scope three. I know there are a lot of data challenges, and we're really not there yet. But I think going beyond singular measurements to realizing that ESG is a bit broader than that, and it is that art and science, isn't it? It's hard to define it through just data alone, and I think that's where the judgment and the excitement really comes in, but also where the challenges comes in.
Absolutely. I think it we really need that active investment style. We need people who understand the companies on a more granular level, because these third party rating agencies and, you know, the estimation methodologies that they have on scope three, they are still quite flawed, and they are still quite early on, and they're maturing, and they're getting better with time, and some, you know, companies are better than others, but it is an art, and it's not yet a science, unfortunately. Understanding, you know, what are the material factors. Even, you know, the conversation for tech companies has evolved over scope three. And so, you know, some of the tech hardware manufacturers, semiconductor companies, et cetera, you know, they are being more scrutinized on the scope one and two front, but then other software companies getting more scrutinized on the scope three front, you know, data center, hyperscalers, et cetera. I think biodiversity is a super interesting topic, and we're nowhere near the maturity that we need to be on that topic. But you know, another area where tech always gets classed as low impact, low dependency, and just gets shoved to the side is not relevant. However, when you actually deep dive and you actually look at some of these, you know, companies, if you look at even the semiconductor manufacturing space, their use of water, their emissions, their pollutants, you know, those actually have a big impact on the biodiversity. And you know, if you go back down to where are these semiconductor materials coming from, you know, they're coming from mining. And mining is one of the biggest impacts to biodiversity. So the question of, like, you know, are you responsible for your value chain? Can you influence your value chain? Can you be supply chain stewards? I think is a big topic, and something that we're really interested in learning from our companies and with our companies, and guiding them through, you know, with that kind of active stewardship lens.
And the trade-off that you mentioned, and just for the listeners, I know I'm throwing in a lot of abbreviations, but ESG is essentially environmental social governance. And there are a lot of trade-offs, as you mentioned, in the mining industry between the environmental and the social sides often. And I think that needs to be taken account, and it is gradually being taken into account. But again, it's very difficult when prioritizing engagement. What should we look at? What should we focus in? The solar industry is a great example of that. A majority of polysilicon manufacturing happens in the Zhangjiang part of China, which is where therefore allegations of forced labor practices, and that's an issue that we're actively monitoring as well. But again, it shows that you need polysilicon for the energy transition, but there are social consequences attached to it, and you need to be mindful of those as well.
Absolutely. And then bringing that back to the financial materiality, you know, when the US puts in bans, the way you can't actually import solar or can't export semiconductors to certain areas in the world because of these ESG factors, because of some, you know, modern slavery and other areas that they've identified, that's a real financial impact to our companies. And those are financial impacts that haven't been there before. And so we really need to help them navigate what the future, what the you know, the new world will look like. Just in terms of, you know, another topic that I think is really fascinating, is our, you know, our net zero, and net zero will look very different depending on geography. It will look very different depending on sector. And, you know, recently we've had some interesting pushes, you know, with energy and supply chain security being at the forefront, you know, bringing manufacturing to places like the US or the UK or Europe that previously haven't had manufacturing of things like, you know, semiconductors, or not to that scale anyway. And then, you know, will they be able to do it as efficiently as other areas? You know, what will that mean for that country's net zero journey? What does it mean? You know, if we've still got the fears around recession looming, we've still got higher interest rates. So currently, actually, you know, purchasing a solar panel isn't as attractive as it was a few months ago for a consumer. And geopolitical tensions continuing, and you know, in the UK, Rishi Sunak pushing out the ICE ban, which for us, you know, hit our electric vehicle stocks as well. You know, how do you view net zero for your companies? How do you view net zero for your investment portfolio? And how do you think we can, as investors, really push that in a positive way?
Yeah, and I think this is definitely a conversation that is in the industry and for valid reasons. And I do think that a lot of factors influence this. I think the nature of your portfolio, your strategy, whether it's long term, short term, what asset class that you're functioning in, all of those things play a part in how you think about this. I think the team that I sit in, we are long-term investors in alternative asset class, and that gives us a luxury to think about long-term mega trends, climate change being one of them. And I do agree that in the short term, it might not be the best decision to hold, for example, a solar stock in your portfolio. But I don't think that detracts from it being a long-term trend and the fact that we need to get to net zero by 2050, not only for our planet, but also for our portfolios, because we won't really have a balance sheet if we don't actually tackle these issues. We engage a lot with real assets, and I think that again gives us a very privileged position on engaging on ESG factors quite meaningfully. Infrastructure is a great example of this. There are valid physical risks to climate change impacting the portfolio now. Hurricane risks, flood risks, drought risks are massive in how we look at the physical risks to our portfolio, and this is something that we take into account. So I do understand that there has been that, again, a lot of headwinds when it comes to how we're thinking about ESG investing this year, especially compared to, I would say, 2020, which was the peak of sustainability in this industry. And I do think that the energy transition debate is extremely important. And again, that kind of ties back to that pragmatic way of approaching ESG investing, where we can't just look at it from we can't have oil and fossil fuels anymore, because while industries and our countries are still dependent on it, and we need to transition out of it in a very pragmatic and sustainable manner, because at the end of the day, we don't want to impact the end consumer. We spoke about inflation and the cost of living crisis, and we don't want to exacerbate it. So it is very important to think about a range of things, but that does not take away from the fact that we also need to look at climate change as a long-term strategy, a long-term trend, and a long-term opportunity as well. I think there are a lot of interesting things. that we're gradually looking at when we think about climate change. And one of those things is just transition. I think going back to the point on looking at singular data to determine whether it's a good or bad investment from an ESG lens can be not a great exercise is looking at emerging market debt, for example. As a sector, it's extremely high in terms of its WACC, in terms of its carbon intensity. But divesting from emerging markets just on the basis of the fact that it's a more polluting sector on your portfolio can lead to a lot of unintended consequences, especially if we're thinking about how, as a world, do we move collectively towards a just and equitable and sustainable planet. So it is extremely complicated when you have things like biodiversity and the trade-offs between E and S and thinking about just transition, where you not only need to focus on the, global north, but also the global south and think about it from that angle. But I think, again, kind of going back to the point that we need to do it in a pragmatic way, and engagement is going to be the bedrock of how we're going to achieve it. And that's why we need a culture that fosters positive engagement. It is time consuming. It takes a lot of resources, but we need to heavily invest in that to actually do it right and do it well.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think another topic that I think is really interesting and kind of hits upon one of our sustainable activity themes that we have for our sustainable future tech portfolio is health tech, and one topic that we've been talking about a lot is Ozempic. And Ozempic, I don't if you don't know what that is, it basically is a glucagon-like peptide receptor type. I mean, these receptor types were first proved to treat type 2 diabetes over 15 years ago and obesity about over 8 years ago. And they help reduce weight through a reduced appetite by mimicking this GLP-1 hormone that targets areas of the brain that regulate appetite and food consumption. And we currently have a new wave of these GLP-1s, such as things like semaglutide, tirzepatide, and retatrutide. That have shown to result in 15 to 25% weight loss on average, with 25% of patients losing over, 20 to 30% of body weight. And this has been a real topic. And again, to Laura's point, it really has been a stock picker's market, because even just like having these kind of headlines, it's been affecting all sorts of different stocks in different ways. And it's been a lot more broad than what we'd normally see. And the impact itself isn't exactly known yet, but what we are seeing is, Ozempic, which is from Novo Nordisk, which uses semaglutide, can be prescribed off-label. And so, the idea of that means if it can be prescribed off-label, it could be used a lot more widespread than other medicine that we've seen before. And we've seen diseases with the most potential direct impact are things like sleep apnea, diabetes, orthopedics, cardiovasculars. But they're also being trialed for a host of other significant medical conditions like Alzheimer's and fatty liver studies. And it basically shows significant reduction in overall calories, with almost 50% reduction over lunch and dinner time. So while a lot of the direct medical or med tech stocks have been hit by these kind of news and headlines and worries, we've seen them hit things like a Nestlé, some of the snack names, because basically people are saying, we'll have less snacks, we'll eat less snacks, because that's suppressing appetite and people will be consuming less calories on average. We've seen payment names being hit where they're geared towards restaurants as people will eat less. We've heard sport equipment being talked up by people who work out more. If the population is less obese, I think a lot of the times it really is again key for active managers to really look through those headlines and really understand what is baked into the price. Sometimes these kind of fears are already baked into expectations being quite low. But sometimes, these are just noise, these are just headlines. And we've had a lot of geopolitical headlines over the last couple of years. And I think, these kind of headlines, again, we need to be able to look through. In the US, for example, these GLP-1s cost about 1 to 1.3 thousand pounds a month, or like 12 to 16,000 pounds annually. And the insurance coverage is currently limited. So over 60% of users pay out of pocket now. So realistically, not everyone will be able to afford these. But then again, that comes into that point of like a just world. If only certain people can afford these kind of these kind of medicines and weight reduction initiatives and will lead different lifestyles. You know, what does that mean in terms of, you know, a just kind of world, and what does it look like in terms of like what consumers will be doing and looking like in the future, and really like digging through the weeds of this and making sure, you know, a lot of the noise that a stock market can bring isn't just kind of taken on board as face value. You know, you do as an investor really need to like dig through these weeds and really understand, you know, what is happening and navigating these hype cycles, navigating these headlines, whether it be AI, whether it be the headlines around Ozempic, whether it be headlines around, you know, the energy transition. Like these are all things that, you know, we have sustainability related or tech related hype cycles. And so it's really key to navigate these. I think, you know, just before we go into questions from the audience, I think one thing that I'm really passionate about and an important takeaway for me, for anyone listening to this panel, is that your money really has power. And even if you're not investing yourself, you know, your choices around your bank account, your savings, your work pension, the things you buy and how you vote has real power. And we're at the cusp of a great generational wealth transfer from baby boomers down to Generation Z and millennials, you know, talking about $130 trillion. So your voice and your choices really do matter. And we have some great investors here on the panel, so we can make use of them at the moment. And, you know, Sam, Laura, maybe if we start with Laura, you know, do you have any tips to young investors? Like, is there any, you know, is money being invested in the right areas? How can we, you know, as retail investors, manage our money a little bit better and understand and challenge the companies that we invest in, and be better, kind of geared towards the future?
Yeah, I think you captured it best when you said, like, you can put your money to work to make an actual impact, whether you're looking at kind of the ESG lens that we've talked about already today, or just kind of selecting the companies that you actually see that long-term value add to kind of whatever values that you see over the long period of time. I think when I look to, you know, hire strategists for my team, it's really about those that show just this degree of intellectual curiosity, right? You're curious about the world around you. You want to learn from people around you. And as well, you just want to have kind of a good sense of what's happening in the global economy, what's happening in the markets. And I think, you know, you don't have to be kind of very specific technical wise, but I think there's certainly scope just to show that passion, enthusiasm, and curiosity when you're discussing markets and what's happening.
Yeah, 100%. And I have not much else to add to that. I mean, making your money work is extremely important. And one thing that I'm very thrilled that as a country, as an educational system, we're getting better at is financial knowledge. And we're teaching that at a younger age. I think it's really important. I think I learned it much later in my life. I wish I learned it in school, but I think it is extremely important to realize that you have a lot of power and you can use that to make real choices. I think there's an interesting anecdote about alternative meats, actually. So we're thinking of investing in alternative meat products as part of our climate strategy and alternative food strategy. And speaking to a lot of people, what I've realized is a lot of people moving into alternative meats are actually people who are already vegetarian and vegans, which is actually not very helpful. What you need is people who are meat eaters to move into alternative meats, because I think that's when there's actual impact. So those are little things that you don't realize, but it is those choices that can have a huge impact. Your demand and supply decisions really dictate how the future is going to turn out. And I find that really fascinating, that anecdote, for some reason, but it just kind of shows that we have a lot of power as consumers. I think the second thing that I would say as a tip, and the world that we live in, it's about hearing every perspective and then making your decision. I think often we get boxed into our echo chamber of knowledge and only maybe read news from a certain source or hear points of view from certain audiences, but actually the world is much bigger than that. We've seen it with the election of Trump, where maybe a lot of people were shocked by that and a lot of people were not. So it just kind of shows that we need to broaden out our perspective, listen to other people, engage in discourse, and then only make our decision, because that's probably the best way to make decisions at the end of the day.
Absolutely. And I would completely echo those points. And I think Not just a wealth transfer is happening, but also just in terms of demographic shifts, like, sustainability and technology first, that is going to be the next, demographic. We are already in that space, and we're already seeing some interesting use cases and some interesting kind of changes in how we live and what we do and how we can improve the world around us, not just from a kind of like ESG sustainability perspective, but also just in terms of that financial understanding, that financial know-how. AI, for example, is unlocking loads of education use cases. It's democratizing access in a lot of areas, and it's enabling people to kind of develop new kind of revenue models, but also for people who couldn't previously participate into today's workforce. And I think it'll be really interesting to see where that will be as young investors, who I assume mainly young people on this call today. I think it's also really important to understand your investment horizon is a lot longer than most people's, so you still have that ability to put on risk. You have that ability to see real shifts in how we operate, how we invest, and to really make sure that you're on that leading edge and understanding where you think where you think we're going. I think that's really, really key. I think another question would be helpful in terms of helping some of the people attending this call is maybe a little bit on how we got into the investment industry and any areas we think are maybe growth areas in the investment industry. For me personally, I see a real growth in sustainability and ESG, but I also see some real growth in actual understanding of investments and on that diversity spectrum, actually engaging female audiences on this. We still see a real lack of female diversity, especially in investments. And so I really think that women invest differently. Women need different investment education. Women can invest and do invest very, very well. And so I think, there's a real push for actually, maybe changing some of these institutions that we've built, maybe changing some of the language that we've built over the years to make it more suitable for females, for gender diversity, but also, LGBTQ plus diversity and all forms of diversity that we haven't necessarily always respected, and pushing not just for the global north, but also the global south, and making sure everybody in that just transition, as Sam has mentioned, is part of this. Maybe Laura, if you have any tips for any budding investment.
I guess an area of interest that's really kind of cropped up more recently is around private investing. So in our kind of strategic asset allocation, which is the way we look at portfolio construction on a 5 to 10 year basis, previously we just looked at, equities and bonds and the so-called 60-40 portfolio, but we are seeing these kind of disruptive shifts happening in kind of the broader macro landscape where private investing, so private credit, private equity, I think are becoming really more opportunistic, and we're seeing more interest, certainly from kind of the new generation in finance heading into that space. So I think that's a growing area. And then obviously sustainability, there's a big push, certainly across BlackRock, but across the industry as a whole. I think that's going to continue to gain momentum as really the transition to net zero is one of our five mega forces. And we think that's really going to be a dominant force in the years to come.
Yeah, I agree with the private markets point. I think it's such an interesting industry, not only from a pure play investment lens, but also from a sustainability lens. The amount of impact that you can make in the private market is really interesting. And we're moving in that direction as well, with our PE and VC focus and focus on illiquids. And it's fascinating, just the sheer amount of tangible impact that you can make in these asset classes, and definitely a space to watch out for. And a space if people want to get into sustainable investing, looking beyond public markets and seeing that there are opportunities in the private market as well.
Absolutely. Now, I don't know if we can take any questions from the audience. I think we have two here. So the first question is, why USA bans on trade, et cetera, most significant compared to other countries, or can only the USA make these certain bans? do any of you want to start, and I can add on to your opinion?
I mean, I guess the way that I would kind of approach this, rather than looking at one country versus another country, I think the overarching theme is that we are in this so-called environment of geopolitical fragmentation. So we're probably at this kind of tipping point where the global economy is probably the most fragmented that we've seen in numerous decades. So on the back of that, we are seeing this rewiring of supply chains, this reshoring. We're seeing this kind of domestication of production. So I think this just captures just the degree of tensions that we are seeing in the global economy. So it's not necessarily about, specific trade bans from one country to another, but just this gradual trend that we are seeing more globally.
Yeah, we're seeing a real push to reshoring. We're seeing a real push to having multiple supply chains and that energy security and supply chain security push. And that's across many geographies. It has been very, very prevalent in the US especially, which I think is that probably why one of the reasons they get mentioned a lot. But also the US is a big economy. It's a big consumer. It's a big force. The US dollar is a big currency globally, and so they will always have that kind of effect. I think they've been a bit more proactive on some of these trade bans, I should put it this way, than other geographies. And that can be down to political reasons, that can be down to cultural reasons. You could probably make your own assumption on why, but I think that's probably one of the reasons why it gets mentioned a lot. And obviously, the geopolitical tensions between the US and China are quite big when it comes to the tech front, because obviously, a lot of tech is manufactured in China or in Asia. And even just semiconductors, they are, mainly in Taiwan at this current moment in time. But also a lot of them get manufactures in China. And there's been a real push, to pull them back into the US. There is manufacturing capabilities in Europe, and there are some leading companies there that have always manufactured in Europe. But I think that's something that's really interesting from a reshoring perspective. Right, so another
And
question.
that's the one thing to add
Sorry.
there, which I think is actually quite interesting, is the agriculture supply chain as well. And we're seeing that there was an article in the FT today about the rice supply chain, and a lot of rice is actually exported from India. And India has put trade bans on rice because of elections coming, and cost of food is a huge topic in India when it comes to re-election and keeping the cost of food down. And therefore, they have restricted rice going into different countries, which is having a huge impact in East Africa, in Southeast Asia, in a large part of the global south. And you can see that it's not just the US, but a lot of different players in the world that we live today, especially with climate change making this issue even worse. Protectionism is becoming more and more rampant. And I think looking at how your country is doing compared to others, with the growing fear of climate change, I think can have severe impacts, especially in countries that are highly dependent on these supply chains. So something to really think about.
Absolutely. And I think another thing that's interesting is if you follow the full value chain, some of those supply chain dependencies can start in the mining area. Some of them can start in the construction phase. Some of them can start in the assembly phase. It depends on what sector you're looking at. And these are real, complicated global supply chains that need to be unpicked. And often the traceability isn't even there. So that is a very, very complex matter.
Another tech opportunity with blockchain there. I think that's probably the best use case of blockchain to have that traceability across the supply chain.
Absolutely. So from Gabrielle, what can be done to make green energy more economically sustainable, and to lower the green premium? I think that's probably more directed at you, Sam, if you have any thoughts there.
So actually, green energy or clean energy is much more affordable than fossil fuels. Solar is at an all-time low. I think the big issue is demand and supply. I think there's the scalability is not there. as it is with fossil fuels. I think there's a lot of infrastructure in one part of the supply chain, but how to actually in the transmission part to the grid is where we're seeing a lot of issues. And we need to scale that up. I think government subsidies, as you mentioned previously, I think in actually the first half of this call, the Inflation Reduction Act in the US is aiming to do just that, reduce the cost of clean energy and green energy in the US and across the world. And I think government subsidies are one way, reducing green premiums, having better carbon trading schemes in the U in EU. I think developing that further is going to be really helpful. But I think the price of fossil fuels is actually a great reason to actually migrate and move towards clean energy. So I know that a lot of people are talking about the energy transition and it's not been a great year for clean energy, but I think it's just a signal showing that that is the future. Fossil fuels are immensely volatile. They're very expensive. They've led to a lot of issues, and they're also concentrated in a very few countries. So I think there's a real push towards green energy, but we need collaboration and help from governments, from private investors, from a range of sources to be able to do this. And that's why it's quite worrying when politicians say, well, not now, because that does not help anyone. And we need to accelerate this rather than stop this.
Absolutely. And sometimes, you know, that help doesn't always have to be in terms of actual dollar investments or tax subsidies or, you know, tax credits. It can be in permitting laws, right? A big bottleneck for renewables is permitting. The other area that is really key is we need to build the infrastructure around it, right? We need storage capacity. We need more grid connections. We need software that's able to manage the volatility of the grid and manage, you know, your electricity use at home and maybe make your EV battery into a storage battery when you're not using it and things like that. Like there's a whole load of accompanying factors that we need to look at. And it's not just, you know, the actual price of fossil fuels or the actual price of the solar panel.
Yeah.
It's often the surrounding infrastructure that also needs to be looked at.
And infrastructure investing is not boring, it's so boring compared to like exciting VC tech solutions. It's not the most sexy topic. And I think it sometimes gets neglected, but it is putting money into that really boring asset class because we need it. And I do think technocratic solutions are exciting and sexy and awesome, but we also need to put money into our infrastructure to build it up because only then can we actually migrate and transition effectively.
Absolutely. And I think just in terms of time, I think the last question, you know, are there any specific topics we would suggest to become familiar with ahead of a scheduled interview, for example? Is there anything you particularly look out for in terms of knowledge, you know, key issues or areas to look up on? Laura, should we go ahead with you first? Sorry.
I mean, I think just kind of making a daily practice of reading the FT, reading The Economist, if you have a Bloomberg terminal, doing deep dives on really the news of the day, looking at key market trends, looking at what investors, how investors are thinking in this current environment. I think that positions you well ahead of potentially other candidates who don't show that same degree of enthusiasm and passion.
I
Yeah,
also
I
think sometimes
agree.
it's just about building an investment case. And you know, that investment case might not always be the correct one and not being afraid to have an opinion, not being afraid to, you know, fail as well. You know, a good stock picker doesn't always pick the stock right stocks all the time. You know, and you just learn from your failures, you grow, but just having that kind of logical, you know, thought process and having a belief and having, you know, that fund that being born out of, you know, data and research, but and investing accordingly. I think sometimes just having that thought process, that investment picking, stock picking thought process, and demonstrating that in an interview, I think is sometimes very critical and very helpful for our candidates. Sam, sorry, you wanted to mention something as well.
No, I just wanted to add to Laura's point that it's about consistency of these readings as well and of this research. I think a lot of times you have interview candidates who have clearly prepared, but probably in the last 48 hours on a certain topic. And I think it unravels quite quickly. I think if you are passionate about working in the investment industry, then hopefully you are also passionate about reading about it on a day-to-day. Just spending 5 minutes every morning and reading about it, but doing it over a long period of time will build up that that judgment that you said, that point of view, rather than just telling me the news, because I think a lot of times we're looking at your analysis, not just did you read the news today? I think that's obviously great, but it's about how you dissected it, how you've synthesized it, and what view you formed at the back of that. And I really think that only comes with consistency. It's work. It takes time. But if you are interested, please read. I would say just read as much as possible. I think that's the best way to build up your financial acumen.
And I think also have courage to be different, have courage to come from a different background. I came from the chemical engineering industry, and I entered the finance world through that. And it was through my engineering skills, it was through my genuine interest in markets and genuine interest in what was happening in the world. It was through my, critical problem solving skills and things like that that I managed to make a career here. And so I think it's also, be courageous and know your skill sets. And it might not always be the most direct transferable skill set into the investment industry, but we need lots of diverse candidates, and we need people who think differently and who have opinions and who do the research. And I think that would be really helpful for anyone. Perfect. I see we're on time. Francesca, I don't know if you want to end anything.
No, just to say thank you so much, everybody. And yeah, for anyone who's joined and got other questions that we didn't get to speak about today, just email either myself or another member of the GAIN team, and we'll come back to you. But no, thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you very much. Bye all.